there were some of us that had the privilege on Friday night to view the movie Voiceless. The movie was about the light to life, and it was a powerful movie. But after the movie, one of the ladies that attended gave me a series of poems that she had written on this very same subject. And I'm going to begin by reading one of the poems that Mary Ann Gorman had penned. And listen carefully to the words. It's entitled, Unable to Speak. I'm in the womb growing each day, made in God's image in marvelous way, arrayed in God's spirit and garment of love, as gentle and harmless as the morning dove, longing to see my mother's face, saddened to know it will never take place. Pain and sorrow fill my heart, unable to speak, I quietly depart. Now, as we focus on the sanctity of life, which this is the Sunday that we honor this, I want to talk more about God's perspective. Because often the issue gets, I think, talked about in what I would call sound bites. We talk about pro-life or pro-choice, a woman's right to choose or protecting the unborn. And when we go about discussions of that nature, we lose perspective, and I think those discussions end up going into debate and even into arguments, and they're not helpful whatsoever. So this morning I want to seek to regain a godly perspective so that you and I can make a proper judgment on the value of life. But to begin with, allow me to use an illustration. I have a $20 bill in my wallet. Who would like it this morning? All right. I see a number of hands going up, but there's others of you that didn't put your hands up because you're thinking, I can't let the pastor think I'm greedy. I really would like that $20 bill, but I'm not going to let him know that I'm a greedy individual. Well, this morning I actually had to borrow a $20 bill, so I don't even care if you took it or not. But this is my $20 bill. So, some of you put your hands up that you would like this $20 bill. Okay. Now how many really want my $20 bill? What? Hands are still going up? Now how many want my $20 bill? After it's been crumpled up and stomped upon, you still want this $20 bill?
Yeah.
Why would you want this $20 bill? Is the paper that it's printed on worth $20?
Yeah.
No. Does it have such a rare and special ink that you could never get anywhere around the world if you pay 20 bucks for the ink?
No.
Why do you still want my $20 bill? To spend.
To spend.
Yes. Willard, you're right, to spend. The reason that you still want my $20 bill is that the creator of this bill, which is the United States Treasury, says no matter what it's gone through, it's still worth $20, right? They guarantee the value of this bill, despite it being crumpled up and stomped upon. With that in mind, I want to pose a very thought-provoking question. That question is, who is then our creator? Who is it that actually places value into life itself? Good answer, Willard. Because we as Christians know that our creator is God. He's the one who has formed us and shaped us. Listen to these words from Genesis 1:27 and also chapter 2, verse 7. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. And then in chapter 2, verse 7, the Lord God formed the man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And the man became a living being. God is our creator. It is our creator. It is he that determines our value. And I think he's given each and every one of us a very unique and special value, don't you? It matters not of race, culture, it matters not of background. It is God who still places value in us. He has given us value by creating you and I in His image and breathing into us the breath of life. But perhaps you're here today and you think that your value is determined by what you add to society, or is determined by what others think about you, believe about you. Isn't it kind of nice when we're valued? How many really enjoy being valued by others? And this is a place that's all right to raise your hand. You know, it's okay. I think we all want to be appreciated. I think everyone in this room wants to know that somebody else has placed some value on us. But I would argue this morning that when we base our worth or other people's worth on what other human beings believe or what society believes is valuable, you and I begin to tread in areas where we have seen some tremendous tragedies throughout history. Several hundred years ago, when human men bought blacks into America and sold them as slaves, they considered these people less than valuable. This wrong thinking of value led our country into human slavery. And it continued for many years. And guess what? It continued even among God-fearing people. Why? Because they believed the lie that others can determine a person's value apart from God. Let me even go on further. In the last century, we've also seen those who have gained power and become dictators in their country, who had no regard for God or what God thought or what God valued, and they themselves sought to value other humans differently than themselves. This type of believing and thinking led to the Holocaust, where 6 million Jews were killed, along with 5 million others. Why? Because they were valued as less than human by those who were in power. What I'm trying to say this morning is when we remove God and take away the value that He's placed on all of mankind, then we lose the fact that He is the Creator, who has created you and me in His own image. And He's one that has breath of life, let me try to get that right, who has breathed life into us. He has brought us to where we are. And we begin down a very dangerous path, a path of tragedy, when we allow society or others to determine value. In slavery, blacks were devalued by others. They were considered less than human. In Germany, the Jews were devalued by the Nazis. They too were considered less than human. So what does that say to us that have gathered here this morning? I think you and I need to learn that we have to be a voice for the voiceless. We have to be a voice for the unborn. In America, as well as in much of the world, the abortion argument hinges on the belief that the baby in the womb is not really human. You see, they devalue that baby. Is that true? Is it really not human? Does the location of the baby determine if it's really a human being or not? Think of that for a moment. You know, over the last several months on Facebook, I've had the privilege, because you have friended your pastor, to see some of the ultrasounds of babies. Here, Brady on our praise team will be having a baby in March. And I've seen some of those ultrasounds, beautiful already, of what God is doing inside this womb. And then Peter and Kristen Wheatley last night gave birth to a baby girl. Arabelle Noel is her name. And I've seen ultrasounds of that baby over the last several months. These are beautiful pictures. And you know, when we had our firstborn, someone gave us a book to keep our memories in. And on the book, the title of the book was God's Masterpiece. is the handiwork of God. God's masterpiece. Are they tiny, these little babies? Yes. Are they human? Yes, they are. Are they valuable? Absolutely. Because God created them and they already bear His image. Are they able to survive on their own? No, they're not. And this is where many will come in with their arguments that until a baby is viable and can survive on his or her own and is not dependent upon the mother, then it's less than human and does not have the same qualities and characteristics or viability as a normal human being. However, if you and I follow that logic, then even newborn babies outside the womb would be eligible to be eliminated. Isn't that true? Because newborns still depend upon their mother or someone to care for them. And it's hard for any one of us in this place to imagine or think that killing a newborn baby or a baby outside the womb is at all acceptable. But Peter Singer, an ethics professor, who's written a number of books, suggests that no newborn should be considered a person until 30 days after birth. Now, you guys are shaking your head and you're like, yeah, now I don't know who this Peter Singer is, but I don't agree. And I think all of us here would think that that type of thinking is crazy and this is just some nuthead, some wacko person nobody'd ever listened to. However, he is presently hired as the professor of bioethics at Princeton University, where he continues to serve in that capacity and continues to bring forth his thoughts and his philosophy on newborns. A baby up to 30 days after birth, he argues, does not have the same values of fully functioning human. So that brings us to the crux of the matter this morning. What does God say about life when he created us? Does he create us in his image 30 days after we're born? Does he create us the moment we come out of the womb? Or does he create us at the point of conception, at some other time? What does the scriptures have to say about all of this? Because truthfully, we should turn to God's word. Well, throughout scripture, we see that God does create life in the womb. And I'm only going to share two verses with you. Listen to what David writes under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit from Psalm 139. For you created my innermost being. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. And then in Jeremiah, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. It tells me very clearly that God creates us in the womb. He creates us in his own image with all the characteristics of humanity, though in much smaller and much developing form. He values life in the womb just as much as he values life outside the womb. So what does that mean for us today? Well, if you've come to that conclusion that God is the creator of life and that we need to protect the womb and that really his image begins at the point of conception, then it must have a powerful effect on how we live our lives and the voice we give to the community around us. Abortion, my friends, however you want to play it out, is taking of a life, something against the very nature and the characteristic of God. And if that's the truth, then silence as a Christian really isn't an answer. It's not an option for us. We cannot sit by and do nothing. That too would be a sin, and we're going to face the judgment as we stand before God if we do that. Because James 4:17 makes this very clear. Remember, it's a sin to know what you ought to do and then do it not. Think about the blacks that were sold into slavery and those that sat by, even though they knew it was wrong, and did nothing. Think about the millions of Jews and others that tried to protect the Jews that were slaughtered in concentration camps. And the number of people that knew what was wrong sat down and did nothing. Was that back then okay? No, it wasn't. Not at all. Is it okay for us today to see this very same thing happening in our own culture? Since the legalization of abortion in Roe v. Wade on January 22nd, 1973, it's estimated that over 50 million babies have been aborted. Are we acting on our convictions that the life in the womb is a valuable human life created in the image of God? Maybe this morning you don't know exactly what to do. What can you do practically? Well, James 1:27 says this: religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this, to look after orphans and widows in their distress. And you may be saying, well, Pastor, that didn't say anything about the womb. It didn't say anything about babies. It talks about orphans and widows. You missed the principle. When James wrote that, the principle was this. What he says, we need to look after those who cannot look after themselves, which would include the unborn. The unborn cannot speak for themselves. Therefore, we got to tell others, whenever we have an opportunity, that we need to protect that which is in the womb because it's valuable. God is the creator. And abortion is the taking of that innocent life. But I really want to go a step beyond that. A step that I think is even more powerful and more practical. You see, we live in a world that, for whatever reason, hasn't come to the same conclusion you and I have come to. We live in a world that they don't believe much in God or what God can do. So I think more importantly, as we share, shouldn't we share the gospel of Jesus Christ? Shouldn't we tell those around us that there is one who can redeem their soul? One who can change and transform them, make them a brand new person? Because as people find Christ, not only does it change their heart, it changes the way they think. And if you really want to change society's thinking, it's going to begin with changing the heart, right? Yeah. Getting the heart right with God. As that happens, then other things will fall into place. But I do want to say this before we show a video here in the next few moments. Abortion and the life of the unborn, they're not political issues. They're not. As much as we want to make them that, they are a moral and spiritual issue that we have to grapple with. Now, a week ago, for those that were here, we gave out an envelope. The envelope had on it, Save the Storks. How many remember when they had pictures of storks delivering babies? How many believe that's how babies came? Just wanted to see how many more hands would go up. I think we figured that out after a while. I think as a kid, I'm like, man, I gotta kill that stork. I got a brother here, I got a sister here. Somebody's gotta take care of that stork. Well, the whole thing with storks is just an image that we used to have long ago about the delivery of babies. But this ministry is saving the unborn. This ministry is being a voice for the voiceless, and they're the ones that produced the movie that we saw here on Friday night. And if you would like to contribute to this ministry, they give you an opportunity. There is a pamphlet there on the back. You can give just a one-time gift, or you actually can give monthly if God calls you to that. If you've taken your envelope home and tossed it somewhere, we got plenty more on the back table. But if you didn't get an envelope, or maybe you left and you just didn't want an envelope, may I encourage you, please, just take one. Take one, pray about it. Pray over it. Ask God if perhaps maybe there's something He would want you to do to express your convictions about Him being creator, and that in the womb is His masterpiece. We're going to be showing a video right now. I just want you to listen to the video, pay attention to the video, and then after which, we're going to leave quietly.
Oh, Jesus, what was I?